Fortress, you go before us. Nothing can can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of a God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Things apart. Well, good morning. That's not bad. We'll try it again. Good morning. Yeah, it's pretty good. If you're a first-time visitor, if you'll stand up and do a dance real quick, we'll take a... I'm just kidding. Don't do that. We're glad you're here to worship with us. Hopefully you can experience God here and maybe a little bit fun along the way and see how things go. A few announcements before we get going. Choir is 9 a.m., so if you're interested in choir, there is a few seats left. I don't know what happens when we get full. We'll figure it out. Maybe we have to expand back. People have to sit in the baptism and get a little wet. This Thursday, there is a leadership training. It is free. So if you are on a team and the head of a team, we ask that you come out. It's from 7 to 9 at the Summit Companies. It's on the Volunteer Parkway. If you have any questions, ask Todd. He can give you all the answers for that. But it's the Five Voices system. It talks about how different leadership types interact with each other and how they think, how they act, how they interact with others. It's a pretty cool training. So go out to that Thursday. There's a fellowship night on April 28th. It's here at the church. There's going to be bingo. So bring out your glasses so that you can read your cards and your chips. And we're going to have a chili cook-off. And again, that's the 28th. The last thing is there is a deacon election. Trace and Brian Phelps are being nominated. So on the 28th, prior to the service, we're going to vote for ballots for active members. So keep that in your prayer. Look over those candidates. The deacons have recommended voting yes for each. And finally, there is a men's golf outing, and that's on the 27th. So if you're interested, see Jake or Scott. And I think you must have an announcement.
George pawned this off on me. Somehow I got ramrodded into being president of the church bowling league this year. So I'm getting to do the honors. This is a 10th year anniversary that our church has had teams in a bowling league. And I want to share some of the highlights, and we have some prizes. Not for everybody I call, but I'll make that clear if you get something. These are five high games this year. Jeff Perez, he didn't come in here, he was in Sunday school, had a 266. Stephen Gillum, George and Tammy's son, had a 265. Tim Mumpower, the captain of my team, had a 259. Jake Cumbo, a 254. And Grace Gillen, a 208. So it looks like, other than Tim Mumpower, the Gillens kind of wrapped that one up. Then we have high averages. Tim Mumpower, 204 average. That's pretty substantial. Jake Cumbo had a 182. Stephen Gillum, a 181. Jeff Perez, a 166. And you would have thought with all those high averages, they could have beat us in the championship, but they didn't. And then I had a 162 average to bring up fifth place on that. I don't see Tim in here. Oh, yeah, there he is. Tim, you want to come up and get the bowler of the year for the highest average for a male? And while he's... yep. And while he was coming, Anna Sizemore, is she in here? Anna's the highest average for the females. Top five ladies' averages, congrats. Anna had a 149, huh? Anna had a 149. Grace had a 146. Gail Gilmer, a 140. Lisa Sizemore, 133. And Lisa Heider, 130. Did I get all that right? All right. The winning team, come on back up, Tim, was Tim Mumpower, another fellow that doesn't go here, Chad Smith, who bowled a 288 in the final game of the tournament to push us over. And there's something in there for Chad, too. And the other two members of that championship team were myself and my son, Tim, who goes to Highlands. And George's notes say the winning team, Rolling Thunder, won by 68 pins in the tournament. And we're looking forward to next year and having maybe some more bowlers come out. We do have this plaque that has the championships on there and the recent ones on it. Be hanging out in the hallway. And I'm done except for, I really want to encourage you to come out to Thursday night. I've been doing leadership stuff for over 20 years probably, and Todd asked me to read this, and I said, I'll read it, but I really can't imagine I'm going to learn anything. And that wasn't a very good attitude, but I had to text him back and say, man, I'm sorry. If I would have had this book and this teaching a bunch of years ago, I could have done a lot better at leading the church and not hurting people. So I highly encourage it. It'll be great for a marriage, communication to learn. It would be great for your work. It would be great for anything. You all would benefit from this training called Five Voices. Give me a microphone.
Thanks. All right, the one last announcement. If you're interested in playing softball, we may have enough to play. Contact me if you are, or George, one of the two. Jeff's in. Jake, we got another. If you're interested, talk to me. We may have a team. See how that goes. It's going to start soon, like within the next few weeks, if we do have a team. But if you know somebody that's also interested, let me know. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, actually, sorry. I forgot one note from Shirley from last week. And bear with me, I am a millennial who hasn't read cursive in a long time, and Shirley's handwriting is so pretty. But let me share this memory with you. Last Sunday service was a most wonderful blessing for me and all my family. A special thank you to Samantha and to each everyone sharing and presenting the special service on mission trips. A blessing and special wonderful memories over a lot of years, and for Walter, that started back in the 90s. Also, there have been so many persons from Kingsway who volunteer to do a lot of mission trips. And I truly believe going with others from here was one of the best things for Walter, and he was able to work together as a team. Bonding together to work and help others meant so much to him. Thank you again so much for my family, and I pray God's richest blessings for everyone here at Kingsway and also for future mission trips. Shirley. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we're grateful for who you are, that you decided that in this other realm that you existed in heaven, that you said, this isn't enough for me. I'm going to create something beautiful, and then fast forward, we destroyed it, but that wasn't the end of the story. You decided to rescue us, and it's that rescuing and that salvation that you offer through Christ's death on the cross, resurrection, proving he's divine, that having faith in you means anything, and that we get to exist in that realm with you forever. But you've promised us that we can start that journey and that trip and that experience here today, and that we're to invite everybody that we can around us. And so as we carry out that mission in our lives and in the world, we pray that you would be forefront in our thought, you'd be forefront in our prayers, that everything that we do here at Kingsway is uplifting to you, honoring you, and for your mission. This morning, I pray you speak through us, through the word, through any testimony, through any singing that we offer up as praise and sometimes as a sacrifice. It's all for you. We love you. It's your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. This morning, our program for this week is for Elizabeth Barton. She is a friend of Todd and Cindy. Her sister passed away very recently, and she was a caregiver for 12 years for her sister. So it's been quite a loss for her. So let's just try to encourage her, fill out your program while Cindy plays us a tune, and then we'll have a prayer afterwards. Thank you. Let's pray. Our most kind Heavenly Father, Lord, we just, Lord, we come to you again. Lord, we're asking that you would help this dear lady Elizabeth to heal in the loss of her sister. Lord, there's so many things that only you can do. And Lord, we pray for your comfort, your guidance. Lord, whatever it is that she needs to invest herself in or whatever it is you lead her to next, Lord, we just pray that you would guide her and help her. And Lord, just use her. Use this time for your glory and honor. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I got to fill in for Robert Sunday school class today, and I got to meet two girls today, Jasmine and Abby. And so it's always nice to, sometimes when we do the same things every Sunday, we don't get a chance to connect with a lot of people. So I was grateful for that. If you'll stand this morning, we're going to sing How Great Is Our God and How Great Thou Art. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all who see how great is our God? Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great. And all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great is our God. Thou art, how great thou art. shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Thank you. You can be seated. Kids, you can come up for Kids Corner.
Well, hi there. That's a bunch of kids. How many of you have ever heard the Bible story about David and Goliath? You want to raise your hand? You've not heard that story? Well, I'm going to talk about it a little bit today, but not quite in the same way you've heard before. David was a shepherd when he was a young boy. He had seven older brothers, and Israel was where they lived, and they were at war. They didn't want to really be at war, but the Palestinian people, they wanted to fight, and they wanted the land that Israel was living on. So three of David's older brothers went to war, and David's dad and mom wanted to send some food because they didn't have like a lot of stuff. They didn't have big things like we have now that can feed our soldiers. So he went, David's dad went to him and he said, will you please take this to your brothers? Because I want to do what I can. And I have some cheese I want you to take for the captain. So they have some good food to eat so they can be strong and maybe win this war. So David went. And I want to read what it says. He went and he wanted to find his brothers to greet them. First he gave the stuff to the captain, all the food, and then he went and he wanted to talk to his brothers. Well, guess what? His older brother said this to him. He said, what are you doing here anyway? What kind of hello was that? David was just obeying his father. He was just bringing food and he just wanted to see his brothers to make sure they were okay. What does he say? What are you doing here anyway? He demanded. That means it wasn't like a friendly hello. What are you here for? No, he was angry. And he said, what about those few little sheep that you're supposed to be taking care of? That's really what I want to talk to you about today. David's older brother was being a bully. Do you know any bullies at school? Hopefully you don't know any at church. It's not fun. It's not fun to be bullied and made fun of. No, we're supposed to be kind to one another and to encourage one another. And David's own brother was bullying him. And he said, I just came to obey my dad. I just came to see you to make sure you're okay.
Another guest is coming,
I think. Oh my goodness. And so I just want to encourage all of you. If you are bullied, don't bully back, okay? Just be kind. You can do it. I know you can. If you don't have anything nice to say, you know what the rest of that is. Don't say nothing at all. You could pray for them when you go home. When you say your prayers, you can pray for that person and be kind to them. It can actually help change the person if you're kind to them. That's all I have. Let's pray, okay? Heavenly Father, you have been the best example of what kindness and love is to us. So help us to be good reflectors of your love and your light, and we have only you to thank for it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Our offertory hymn is Great is Thy Faithfulness. Please stand and sing all three verses with me.
Thank you for a great day, and thank you for a greater day to be in your house to worship you. Pray that everything we do here at Kingsway bring praise, honor, and glory to your name. Now be with the gift and the giver if we give back a portion to you to help build up your kingdom. These things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. This is very strange. I'm here by myself. Normally when I get asked to sing, I bring others with me. So anyway, go ahead. Somebody's praying.
Thanks, Jeff. That was great. Well, in John chapter 9, and I'm going to ask you if you will stand in God's great honor, our great God's honor. Get my words right here. I just want to read in John 9, verses 13 and 14. So if you'll just follow along. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind.
Now, the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this man who he had never been able to see, Lord, and it all changed when he met you. Father, each of us have different needs that are plaguing us, Lord. We may think, this is never going to be resolved, or I may never find healing. And I bet this guy thought that too. Father, I just pray you would heal today. Heal us where we are, Lord. You know the different needs. And Father, as we look at the neighborhood and how the different people had to deal with what you did, Lord, do something in us, Lord. We just need you. Move among us, Lord. Speak, quite frankly, in spite of me, Lord. I just pray that your spirit would be clear and evident as we look at your word and your truth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I grew up in the 1960s in Hendersonville, North Carolina. And I didn't know there were any problems in the neighborhood until my neighbor, Mr. Hossapple, and when I was little, I thought his name was Mr. Horseapple. And so he came and he knocked on our door and several other doors. And he had this major problem that he was desperate for the neighbors to fix. I didn't realize it at the time. Looking back, now I do. Next door, actually it was our house, a black family was moving in. He was really upset about that. And he tried to bring the neighbors together to stop this from happening. Family did move in. They didn't make it a year. And then they moved out. You know, I look back on that and I didn't understand what was really going on at the time. And I would like to say, Mr. Horseapple or Hossapple, he was the only one I know that ever did anything publicly that would have made them feel unwelcome or not wanted. But I also have to say, I didn't see anybody bringing them cookies, or I didn't see anybody inviting them over to their home or reaching out to the family. And there was even some embarrassing things done to try to get under this family's skin. And you know, I think about that, and it makes me think about the neighbors that are around us. And sometimes we think, well, this is how this person is different, and we're uncomfortable, and so we don't want to talk to that person or this person. And there are all these things that make us different, whether it's the color of our skin, the culture that we were raised in, the place we came from, if our family was rich or poor, or whatever these different dividers are that separate us. But yet, you know what the simple truth is? We are much more alike than different. We all have the same needs and the same feelings. And I always think about the fact that, guys, I am a great sinner. And people may not want to hear it, but we are all sinners. We have all broken God's heart. But here's what I love. Even though I'm a great sinner, He is a greater Savior. And that is the incredible, awesome hope for the child of God in Christ Jesus. Man, these things that separate us, I have found most of the time, the reason I don't like the guy is I haven't taken the time to really get to know him. So often in my life, there are people I didn't even really want to get to know. But once I had the opportunity to get to know them, you know what I discovered? They really weren't that different than me. And God was able to work in me. You know, it says in Romans 2, verse 11, for God does not show favoritism. He doesn't really care about all those things that seem to separate us and divide us. He loves everybody. And His heart's desire is that all of us would find our way back home to Him, our Creator, the One who loves us. Well, this morning, we're really looking at a neighborhood where this blind man lived, and something dramatic happened to him. We know he was blind, and now he is able to see. And all of the neighbors had to deal with that. It impacted everyone that lived around this man. Friends, neighbors, family, local spiritual authorities, the Pharisees, all these people made up a neighborhood. I always think, you know, this must be the passage. I didn't even look up the history of it. Must be the passage where John Newton in his song Amazing Grace got those wonderful words, "I once was blind, but now I see." As this was the testimony of this man, once blind, but now he is able to see. You know, I think about the people that are around us, and we live in a culture that is becoming less aware of the Bible, of church, and it seems like something that's kind of strange and distant because people are not exposed to church and Christians many times. And so I'm afraid many people have the idea, man, I'm okay with you loving Jesus. Man, you can even stick a sign in your yard that says, "I love Jesus." But really, don't talk to me about it, okay? I mean, you kind of make me feel uncomfortable when you start talking about sin. And you know, I think, well, do you think you're better than me? Is this why you're talking like this? You see, there's an idea. You can love Christ, but just keep it private. But here's the problem. Here's the issue. When you really meet Jesus, and you really take a look at what He did for you, how He saw how you were wandering around, and you needed guidance, and you needed help, and you needed love, and you needed direction. And so He died upon that cross, and He provided that which we so desperately need. How can you keep that private? The simple matter is, it is not to say I'm better than you. It is to say, if it were not for Jesus, so I want to look at four characteristics that we find in this passage about unbelievers that I think pertain to all kinds of people. First is that they tend to be ritualistic. Notice in our text here in verse 14, it says that he opened the man's eyes on a Sabbath. Look at verse 15. It says, "Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He put mud on my eyes, the man replied, and I washed, and now I see." I like just the clear, simple way he shared his testimony. He said, well, it was like this. I was blind, but Jesus changed that. Now I can see. It goes on in verse 16. He says, "Some of the Pharisees said, this man's not from God. He does not keep the Sabbath." Man, what were they saying? They were saying, he doesn't follow our rules. He's breaking our rules. How can he know God and not keep our rules? The problem was, they had written rules on top of God's rules, and they weren't really fully keeping God's rules like they claimed. Notice in verse 13 it says, "They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind." Who? It was other people in the neighborhood. They had watched this guy, and they thought, if only he could see. And I think they really cared about him. But what can I do? How can I help a guy that can't see? And so several of them began to talk, and they helped this guy find his way to Jesus. They came before Christ with him, and the Pharisees were mad about it. Why? Because you weren't supposed to work on the Sabbath. And believe it or not, part of work was healing. There was a book known as the Mishnah, which were laws that were written in addition to the Scriptures, God's law, in order to explain God's law. The problem is their explanation wasn't truly connected to God. There were 39 types of work that they had designated as off limits on the Sabbath. I'm not going to share with you all 39, but I do want to share with you three. The first one is, you are forbidden to heal on the Sabbath. And so the picture is, if someone was dying, you could keep them alive, but you weren't supposed to really better their physical condition. So you were not allowed to heal. The second one is, you were not allowed to knead bread, because that was work, to work your hands through that dough and to knead that dough so that it would be ready to become bread. Third, sounds kind of strange, but you were not allowed to spit on the ground. Now, you know why you weren't allowed to spit on the ground? Because the prevailing theory was, if you spit on the ground, it might hit the ground and cause a little furrow in the ground. And guys, that would be like plowing. And that was considered work. And so they decided, hey, we have to go to the religious leaders, the Pharisees, and make sure that they're okay with Jesus and what he has done. Well, what did Jesus do? He broke all of those. Is the interesting thing. Every single one of them. He took the mud. There was spit. And he took the mud and he placed it on the guy's eyes. And the guy was healed. And suddenly everything changed. What was Jesus saying? He was making a bold declaration. There is a purpose for the Sabbath. But I'm not interested in what you think. I'm interested in it bringing glory to God. And when it hurts people instead of helps people, when you're upset because I want to heal somebody, you don't understand the real reason for the Sabbath. As a matter of fact, 7 times in the Gospels, Jesus healed on the Sabbath. I'll just go through these quickly. In Matthew 9, there was a man with a withered hand. Jesus healed him on the Sabbath. Made these guys mad that time. In Mark chapter 1, there was a demoniac, demon-possessed. Jesus cast the demon out of him, set him free, and it happened on the Sabbath. They weren't happy about that either. Further down in Mark chapter 1, Peter's mother-in-law has a fever. Guess what day it was? The Sabbath. So he healed her of that fever on the Sabbath. In Luke chapter 13, there's a story of a woman who is crippled. She's been bent over for years because of her condition. Jesus healed her body. She'd been that way, it says in the text, for 18 years. He did it on the Sabbath. Luke chapter 14, there's a guy with dropsy, which means his arms and his legs are swollen. Jesus healed him of that condition. And then in John chapter 5, there was the paralytic at the pool of Bethsaida. Jesus healed again. So here he is again. Here comes that guy. He's always causing trouble. He's healing people on the Sabbath. How dare he? Man, you know, it sounds crazy. You know, you hear that and you think, who wouldn't be happy to see somebody healed on the Sabbath? I'll tell you who. People who put policy over people. People who put rules over relationships. That is not Jesus. Jesus came to the cross not to fulfill a bunch of rules, but to save a bunch of people. To help and to minister and to heal a bunch of people. That was the work that he accomplished. There are people out there, they're following rules, they're following rituals, they're trying to keep all of these ceremonies. But they're missing the relationship with God, the friendship with God, the awareness of who our God is. So that was the first one, to be ritualistic. The second one is to be skeptical. Unbelievers can be skeptical. It's this skepticism that keeps them from Christ. I read just a couple of verses here, starting at verse 18. It says, "The Jews did not believe he had been blind and had received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. 'Is this your son?' they asked. 'Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that he can now see?' 'We know he's our son,' the parents answered, 'and we know he was born blind, but how he can see now? Who opened his eyes? We don't know. Ask him. He is of age. He can speak for himself.'" So, first, these guys did not believe this was a miracle. They were skeptical. There's got to be some other explanation. Some kind of, you know, fake healer. He didn't really do this. He's trying to deceive people. You know, I hate to say it, but I know in my days there's been some of those people, charlatans out there, people who claim to do miracles and they're caught. And they do this stuff in the name of God's people, and it hurts everybody. But that was the claim that they made, that maybe Jesus, he didn't really heal him. We don't really think that happened. And so they went to the parents in verse 19, and they asked, "Is this your son who you say was born blind?" So the second thing they said, "Are you sure he's really blind? Are you sure that he was always blind?" Still skeptical, still not understanding. Then in verse 24, they said, they again called the man who was blind and said to him, "Give God the glory. We know this man is a sinner." So what are they really saying? I believe what they're really saying is, we know Jesus is a fraud. There is no way he really healed your son. You need to come clean. You need to tell the truth. Reminds me of the story of Achan in Joshua chapter 7, who had put aside some of the plunder after a war for himself, and he was called out by Joshua. Joshua spoke to him, and he said, this is from Joshua 7, "Give the glory to the Lord God of Israel. Tell me what you have done. Do not hide it from me." In other words, they were saying, "Fess up. Tell the truth." Third, unbelievers can be irrational. Sometimes they're skeptical, but they can also just be totally irrational in what they say and their arguments. Verse 26, "Then they said to him again, 'What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?' He answered," the blind man who used to be blind answered him, "'I told you already and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?'" In other words, how many times do I have to tell you? I was blind, now I see. You're not listening. You're missing him. You're missing the whole point. Of course, they get defensive. They're offended. And they say, "You are his disciple, but we are Moses' disciples." In other words, we're the guys running the show. We're the guys who really have the truth. We're the guys you really need to listen to. But then he figures out, I believe, the reason they keep asking him the same question over and over, like a lawyer, they're just trying to find something to criticize him for. They're trying to find discrepancies in his testimony. They're trying to falsify the testimony that he has given. So, to sum that up, first they didn't believe a miracle even happened. Then they didn't believe he was born blind, that it was made up. Then they thought it was a fake healing, a staged healing. And now they're trying to discredit him for his testimony. Notice in verse 30, it says, the man answered, "Now that's remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes." They said, "We know God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly man who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." I'm sorry, this is the testimony of the guy that was blind. He says, God doesn't listen to sinners. So who is this guy? I love it. He has a major premise. He has a minor premise. His major premise, God doesn't hear sinners. His minor premise, God obviously heard Jesus because I was blind. Hey, now I can see. Only God can heal blindness from birth. It's the argument. Jesus just healed this blind man. Therefore, Jesus must be God. Sometimes the arguments against Christ and God, people are working so hard to try to keep from saying Jesus is the Christ, that Jesus did rise from the dead, that God is who He said He is in Jesus Christ. Sometimes they're working so hard to fight against that that their thinking is irrational. Part of our job, Jesus said, the first and greatest commandment is this, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind. Man, we're called to think. God has called us to love Him with our heart, but He has also called us to use these brains of ours, where there are questions to study and to ask God to provide the answers. As a matter of fact, it says in 2 Timothy 2:15, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. God says, hey, look for those answers. So, ritualistic, skeptical, irrational, and I got the last one here. Notice how closed-minded they've become. Look at verse 22. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for already the Jews had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. In other words, the threat was, if you don't do what we say, you're going to lose the way of life that you know. We're going to kick you out of the Jewish synagogue. We're going to kick you out of the neighborhood. You're no longer going to be a welcome part of this community. But you know, I love his response in verse 25. This man certainly was not a coward. He replied, whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see. Sometimes we think the great testimonies are the dramatic ones. I used to drink 2 cases of beer every day, and God delivered me. Or I was so strung out that half the time I didn't know what day it was. Or I did this, or I did that. Let me tell you, the greatest testimonies, regardless of what you did, is what Christ has done. What He's done in your life. How He changed and forgave and gave you that new start. Those are the great testimonies. Actually, sometimes I, instead of all the drama, I just appreciate the humble heart, the humble testimony that says God met me right where I was and He loved me. Verse 34, we see how they had just intended to just kick him out, throw him out. It says, to this they replied, you were steeped in sin at birth. So they're attacking him. You sinner, how dare you lecture us? How dare you talk to us about what to do? And they threw him out, but it did not stop him from talking and sharing his heart. You know, there are people out there that said, you know, I'm too smart to believe in something I can't really physically see with my eyes or hear with my ears or detect with, you know, the five senses. I just can't possibly believe that. And they have this idea that I'm not going to believe, even if it proved to be true, I'm still not going to believe. What does that tell me? It tells me that what you have is not a problem with your mind in believing it. You have a problem with your will. That even if you found that it was true, you would not change your mind. And that's what repentance is. It is to change your mind so that you agree with God. As a matter of fact, John 6:44, Jesus said, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him." So see, here's the deal. Even with apologetics and even the importance of learning, the importance of finding answers that you can share, you know, with your mind and discovering those answers and properly sharing them, still, no matter how good you may be at convincing someone for them to change, it has to be conviction, which is the work of the Father, the work of the Holy Spirit, as He speaks to our hearts. And suddenly, I was blind, but now I see. He opens the eyes. He opens the heart. And until that happens, I might be able to convince you of something, but someone else can convince you out of it. But if God convicts, it's a totally different story. Now, I gotta wrap this thing up. So what do we do as we look at each of these? First, for the ritualistic person, the one who's into ceremonies, don't get sidestepped talking about this ceremony or this ritual or this is the right way to worship God and this is the wrong way to worship God. Focus on Jesus. Focus on the Savior. Focus on the one who has the power to set you free, not whether you agree or not with a certain ceremony or a certain observance. That's not the point at all. Second, for the one who is skeptical, 1 Peter 3:15 tells us, "In your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer for the hope you have, but do this with gentleness and respect." So in other words, man, set your life apart for God. Give God your heart, submit yourself to Him, and be prepared to give an answer. If you don't have the answer, seek to find the answer, but don't ever try to argue anybody into the kingdom of God. Don't ever try to argue anybody to follow God. Be respectful. Be gentle. That's what the Scripture tells us. Tell your story, how God impacted you. Number three, to those who are irrational, well, it's going to take some time building a relationship with them, looking together over some of the questions that they have, encouraging them to seek God and to pray and say, "God, show me the truth, Lord. Do that work." And then lastly, to those who are closed-minded and hard-hearted and they're just not ready. So you need to back away and you need to pray for them. Instead of trying to force them into some kind of decision, you need to step away and you need to pray for them and say, "God, open their heart at the right time. And if you want me to be a part of that, then show me so I can be. But Lord, I understand at this point you don't seem to be at work, so neither should I be working there. I need to step away." We close with this story. This was written in New Yorker magazine years ago, and it was about a guy in Long Island, New York, who bought a very expensive barometer. And he finally got the barometer in the mail, and he was so excited. And he took it out of its package, and he looked at it, and it had a dial. And it would have the weather state on the different categories of the dial. And the arrow was stuck on hurricane. And it was a beautiful day outside. And he thought, "I paid all this money for this barometer, and it's not working." So he shook it, and he banged it. It's not good for something expensive. He banged it. Still, the dial would not move. It still was fixed upon hurricane. So he immediately wrote a letter that he sent off saying, you know, you guys ripped me off. I spent all this money on this barometer. It doesn't work. He put it in his mailbox, headed out to work that morning. When he came back home, there was no mailbox. Even worse, there was no house. There was a hurricane that came through, a true story, in September of 1938. And there were a number of homes that were destroyed, and his home was among those homes. Guys, people may be skeptical. People may be irrational. People may be totally closed, but that doesn't mean a hurricane's not coming. It doesn't mean that there's not a storm on the horizon, even though it looks like blue, clear sky with no storm in sight. We never know when that time will come when we will meet our Maker. We never know the exact moment or time that Jesus will come. It says He'll come like a thief in the night. And so we need to be ready now. We need to make sure that our hearts are prepared now. Only Christ can bring peace in a coming storm. Let's pray. Lord, I thank You for Your Word, Lord. Father, we need to be the kind of neighbors that love You and love our neighbors, Lord. With a love not that says, look at me and how good I am that I'm doing this stuff, but rather with a kind of love that says, man, I remember before I met Jesus how I just needed Him. And I want You to know Him. Father, I pray today if, anyone happens to be here listening online and find themselves in that state of, it's just chaos, it's just a mess, and I need peace. You are called the Prince of Peace for a reason, Jesus. May You speak. May we respond. May we just say yes to Your call, Lord, this morning. And may we just trust You. So, Father, I just pray You move among us, Father, whether we need to come to the altar to pray or whether we need to come forward to share with Your people what You're doing in our lives and our hearts, whether we need to follow You, take that step of obedience and confess our sins and pray and find forgiveness and then follow through with baptism, which is just showing everybody, I'm serious about this. I really do need God. And now I've found Him. Father, just work in this time we call invitation, and may You get glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please stand.
It is finished. I will not boast in anything.
Appreciate Scott's announcement this morning. The word to the seminar on Thursday night. And, of course, we do want members, as many as can, from our leadership teams. But really, like Scott said, it's good for anybody. So you are certainly invited to come. I think it'd be a blessing for anyone to come on Thursday night from 7 to 9. So let's read our scripture. And then we'll pray, be dismissed. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. 1 Peter 3:15. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for loving us so much, Lord, that you'd rather leave the throne and come here, because that was frankly the only way that we could be home with you one day. Thank you for that love, Lord. Help us see the neighbors that we have out there, whether they're in the homes in our neighborhood or, Lord, just a normal path we take each day, Father, that, Lord, I just pray for divine appointments. God, help us to be your messengers, just simply sharing. And once I was blind, now I see. Jesus changed everything. Father, help others to see. We're loved, and we want you to know, Lord, that you too can find that love. It's available. So, Father, thank you for a chance for us to be together. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
People, come awaken the city.